Hi, this is Trisha from Interviews from the Edge. I'm talking to Johnette Napolitano from Concrete Blonde. How are you doing today, Johnette?
I'm great. How are you doing?
I'm doing pretty good. Beautiful weather here in Atlanta.
Oh, it's beautiful here in the desert, but it always is.
You've got a farm now. You've got animals.
A little bit of a ranch. Yeah.
Do you ever have problems with the coyotes? I have a friend that has a ranch out in the desert. He said he has to watch out for the coyotes.
Oh, yeah. My little twins, I have little twins that are half Chihuahua and half Shih Tzu. And they got out one night, about 11 o'clock at night, and came back bloody. I had to keep Chewy alive all night long until the vet opened in the morning because we don't have an emergency vet up here. I didn't want to move him. So they were both chewed up real good. It's a miracle that they both pulled through. So I don't let them out anymore. The goats are fenced in and the horses are fenced in. Everybody's pretty fenced in and Coco's our watchdog. He definitely scares anybody off if they think of coming too close.
I'm sure that when the coyotes see your little chihuahuas, they look like little pork chops, like in a cartoon.
I'll tell you what, little Chewy is a mean little, he's small, but he'll fight anything. He's got a problem with one of my horses. I think he weighs like 7 pounds, but he'll just go after him as if he were a Rottweiler.
Yeah, that's the dog for you.
Yeah.
You're a tough chick, too. I'm so excited that you guys are back and making music. Bloodletting is in my top 10 albums of all time. Of course,
well,
I'm sure everybody says that.
not everybody says that at all.
Well, it was a great breakout album. The first time I ever saw you, I turned on the TV and you came on and it was just you and your bass. And you did Joey live and blew my doors off. I was so impressed. I went right out and bought the record.
Wow.
I know people listen to Joey and all of the other hits that you've had over the years. It just can't compare to you doing a live performance.
Well, thank you very much. I'm humbled and don't know what to say. Just do what I do. I don't really know where it comes from. You know, I started playing piano when I was about 5, and my dad bought me guitar when I was about 8 or 9. It's just something that I was born doing, basically, and so I've never really thought of it one way or the other. I started playing before I even was old enough to listen to records or anything. You know, a lot of people heard a Dylan record or something, and they decided they wanted to write songs or whatever, but it's not like that with me, really. It was just something I started noodling around and doing when I was little. I was a very creative kid. I was drawing from the age of 5, sewing and drawing and all that. And it's nice to be in a place. It's almost full circle. I wanted to get back to the place, back to that person that I was before I started to drive. You realize that before you started to drive is when you were doing stuff that you really like doing. And the minute you start to drive, it all becomes social. You're going places because there's places to go. But when you can't drive, you're a kid, I'd be in my room sewing, drawing, or playing guitar all the time. So now it's like, what do I really want to do? Well, I'd like to be left alone all day to sew, draw, play guitar. You know, we don't change that much, really, but we tend to, I think, lose things as our lives get busier. And in the end, it's just the simplest things that really made us happy.
You were really lucky. You said your father bought you those instruments.
Yeah, but here's what happened with my dad, though, and I love him and I miss him terrifically, but it was always great to play guitar at family dinners and Thanksgiving and everything, but then when I got to be 18, 19, I couldn't see myself doing anything else for a living. And then my dad was not happy at all. He was just like, no, hang on. You know, Italian-American, first-generation American born to immigrants, and that's what your woman's supposed to do. The minute I graduated high school, I got to get serious. I'm playing guitar and doing what I do. It wasn't really serious, real life. But to me, it definitely was. That's what I intended to do with my life. And it came to, you know, I didn't speak to my father for 17 years at one point. Then we did get back our relationship together, and he was insanely, intensely proud of me. He just didn't understand it, but he was very proud of me. You
know? I'm sure that you were kind of a weird kid to him anyway. You were like goth before there was goth.
I was a weird kid, and to know why, to know whether it's nature or nurture, is difficult to say because the childhood wasn't an easy one. But I was a weird kid. It's the first time I ever heard the word eccentric is when my dad used to ask me, why do I have to dress so eccentrically all the time when I was in high school? So, yeah, I guess so. When I look back now, I think so because I had the same thoughts in my head when I was 2 years old as I do now. And the logic completely applies. It applied then and it applies now.
My mother used to ask, why do you have to look like Gene Simmons to go to the mall?
Have you seen this awkward family photographs? You gotta get into awkward family photographs because that's exactly what they are. They're a bunch of awkward family photographs. There's always like the nice little family. And there's one kid who looks like Edward Scissorhands.
That's
a fascinating subject in general, is nature or nurture and who comes out to be different. It's a fascinating subject all the way around, really.
You play piano, you play guitar, but you are an amazing bass player. I have talked to Kira, who was the bass player for Black Flag. I've also talked to Mike Watt, who played for the Minutemen, and now he's playing with...
Yeah, he's brilliant.
He calls it his thud staff. It's not a bass, it's a thud staff.
He's a real bass player, though. I mean, he knows what he's doing. The thing is, I guess I'm able to fool a lot of people, but the only reason that I learned to play bass is because we could not find a bass player that wanted to be in the band. We weren't doing what anybody was doing back then in the 80s. Mm-hmm. We were a guitar bass band. So that was the reason we couldn't get a bass player. And I decided, well, hell, I should just learn to play bass myself. I think the Police had just come, and obviously they kind of blew everybody's socks off, but I just was really impressed. I mean, Sting was really impressive. Mm-hmm. He wrote really great songs, and he could play bass. And I figured, well, if he can do it, I can do it. Because basically, he's a human being with four limbs like me. And as a matter of fact, I would encourage that as an attitude for everyone. You know, we're all basically the same. There are very few things that a human being can do that you can't. Mm-hmm. So I picked up the bass, and I started writing songs on the bass, which was the only thing I could do, because I'd sit and listen to records and play along. When I think of the stuff I used to play now, I used to learn some pretty complex stuff, but I basically started writing songs on the bass that I could play and sing at the same time, and it was hard. I was extremely self-conscious of my playing for a very long time, probably just up until a couple of years ago. All right, I'm going to leave you guys to have whatever orgy you're having going out on the porch. The twins are brother and sister, and all they do is wrestle all day, which is just amazing. It's really funny. But then Coco gets in the mix, and then they're all tumbling around. And then it's like having a house full of kids, except they're more fun.
They don't talk back.
And I don't have to send them to college give them money. But it's nice for you to say that I'm a good bass player, because I really don't know half the notes I'm playing. I just play what sounds right, and over the years, the band has learned to trust me immensely, but they probably didn't learn to do that until I joined the Heads. I was in the Talking Heads for a little while. Uh-huh. That was incredible, you know, that was really great. I got a whole new level of respect from some people, including members of my own band. It's like, look, I'm actually a valid musician as well. It didn't start out that way because Jim Mankey, of course, he was in Sparks.
Yeah.
So he'd been a rock star before and really was the most accomplished musician in the band because he's older, you know. So just in terms of experience and accomplishment, Jim was the guy. But eventually, I grew up and got a lot of experience and learned how to play. But more important than that, I don't play like anybody else, and I still don't know sometimes what I'm playing, but I can sing any note I want. Jim can play a chord, and I go, no, that's not the chord. It needs this note. And then he'll know immediately what chord it is. I still work that way quite a lot with the band. I'm fascinated with Mozart. I can read music, but I just don't see that I need it in rock and roll unless I'm going to do a rock opera or something. And I hear Mick Jagger literally will go up to the drummer and dance the drum part. You better know the beat he's got in his head. You can sit with chart music in front of you all you want, and it won't make any difference if you don't have the soul to feel it. You know, I hear things. They come to me. It's my job to get them down, record something as fast as I can once I get an idea, because I never know if it's going to stick, you know?
Yeah.
Sometimes they do, sometimes they don't.
I was going to ask whether you actually write music with your bass or if you had another instrument that you preferred to write with, but it sounds like you've kind of gotten that down.
You know, the Bloodletting songs, actually, most of them were written on guitar because we had been touring so much before that record that all I could do is sit in the dressing rooms for hours at a time with a guitar, and that's all we did. We didn't have computers then. We didn't have cell phones then. That was all you could do out there. That was it. We had basically no money. And the best you could hope for was a good hotel bar that you could hang out in all night with whoever other band was staying in the hotel. You know, you could really go nuts because there's nothing to do. But the thing that you could do was sit around all day and just write songs. I don't write on the road anymore. I haven't in a long time. But I'm out there for another reason, I think. It's two different things now. I don't know. It's different now. But we had all the songs done on guitar. So for the basic track, I play guitar with Paul Thompson, who we'd met, I think, the night before, and played the basics with Paul on guitar, so that the songs were there. Then we did overdubs from then on out, so the bass was actually overdubbed on that record because it was all written on guitar first.
Yeah, it's such a huge hit, that kind of sudden success, that kind of big success. You can kind of get lost in all of the promo and things happening, and you've now disconnected yourself. Did you feel like you needed to do that at some point just to maintain your sanity and your writer's voice and the artist inside you? I'm sure they were pulling at you all
the
time.
Yes, I did, definitely. I wanted longevity. I wanted to be an artist all my life, and I intend to be an artist all my life. I do not intend to retire. I want to continue at a pace that enables me to do what I know I love doing. I don't want it to mutate into something that I don't love doing. I've had a lot of jobs, and we all do, where we have to go to work and we don't feel like it. Art should not be one of them. If I don't feel like creating, I simply won't. I'll do something else, because there's no substitute for pure inspiration, and you can tell when it's there and when it's not. I'm born in Hollywood, live in L.A. The city is expensive, and in a long-term basis, as an artist, if you're lucky enough to get offered a job that you hate, or a song that you don't want to sing, or have to take a gig you don't want to take, that I don't want to do. I don't want to ever be in a position where I have to do that. So it meant taking a good overview of everything in terms of what ultimately makes you happy in life, what you need, what you don't need. It's your value system. What's important? You know, I want a simple life. And I need space. I'm on 5 acres, so I can get up. If I want to make noise in the middle of the night, I can do it. Mm-hmm. It's that freedom is extremely important to me because I pay attention to my own rhythms. And I think it's basically just to have enough space around you so that you can hear your own rhythms. And people can't really do that. That's why everybody's out of sync, you know? Yeah. I'll book a tour or something, and it'll just feel like the right time of year to do it, and then I'll go back over my charts or my systems that I have of checking out the patterns of the universe and find that I've done it at exactly the right time. Astrologically, I couldn't have picked a better time, but I don't look at that. I don't really live my life that way deliberately. It's just that when you're in tune with your own rhythms, you will find that you sync up with the way things are supposed to go. And it's easier for me to do that without all the distractions and temptations. I mean, there is nothing that you can't get in L.A. 24 hours a day. So when you're sitting there at 2 in the morning baked and want, like, you know, a pizza, you can get one.
Chinese food.
It's just too much of everything for me at this stage in my life. I've done Hollywood to death. Those kids got nothing on the way we used to party.
That's right. And we used to do it from the Army surplus store and the thrift stores and...
Yeah, we
need all the bling.
No, exactly, and you don't need it now either. Conspicuous consumerism, I can't understand why. The divide is so incredible. Either people have tons of money or no money. It's just bizarre.
Another thing they seem to not understand, I have screwed up so many times, and I have been in embarrassing situations. You go into a place and you don't fit in and you look ridiculous, but by the end of the night, you are the life of the party. You learn to take every failure and find some success in it or learn something from it. Now, if you didn't get a thing out of it or money, they don't consider it to be a success.
Well, that started a couple generations ago. That's what the 80s were all about. But the thing is, without any kind of foundation, which is spiritual, everybody's idea of success is quite different. A psychic told me once, and I've had some really great ones, teachers, you may not be rich, but you'll be comfortable. Well, that's probably the most important thing to be, because I know some rich people who are very uncomfortable. And no matter what, corny as it sounds, your health is the most important thing. So you've really got to define what success means to you. Most people, they don't really know what that is, but they know what their parents' idea for them of success is. And that's your number one enemy, man. That's what rebellion is all about. That's a cycle of life, and it's very natural. Do you fulfill what your parents want as your destiny? That's the number one problem you've got. You want to please your parents. You are born wanting to please your parents. And sometimes to become your own person, you have to displease them very much. And that's a very painful thing. But that's what love is about, because in the end, it doesn't matter. You're going to love each other anyway. But I find that most people really have no concept of what being their own adult is. had basically patterned themselves behind their parents, which is great if you've got good ones. But even bad ones, they're humans too, and they made mistakes and screwed up, just like you said. So that's the mystery of life, man. You get older and you just go, Jesus, my parents were only 19. What did they know?
Yeah. I want to thank you so much for joining me today, Johnette.
I had a great time sitting on the porch having a glass of wine talking to you. Okay. We'll do it in person when I see you then, okay?
All right, I'll see you when you come to town.
All right. Talk to you soon, honey. Bye.
Bye.